needs no introduction. Someone that you know well. Someone who left an extraordinary mark in his time in Washington. And who is leaving an impressive mark as one of the key members of Mario Monti's government. But before I introduce him, let's enjoy a 90-second video on 2013, the year of Italian culture in the United States.
Thank you very much, Ambassador Bisognero. I think that your talent for asking questions comes right away tonight. It was a very difficult question, and I understand that the audience was really puzzled to see a face which is so new to this arena. Buonasera a tutti. Sono veramente felice di essere con voi e di portarvi il saluto cordiale del Presidente del Consiglio Mario Monti e di tutto il Governo. È una partecipazione corale dell'Italia, del Governo, delle istituzioni italiane di essere qui con questa grande comunità, con questa grande NIAF. I love coming here, and this year more than ever. I like it because the NIAF honorees, so prominent tonight, who have been announced already, come from every walk of life, and they represent the best of America and Italy, and they embody our strong bonds of friendship. And these bonds grow stronger every year and help us face even one of the worst financial crises that we have ever been through. The Italian government wasted no time, let me tell you, wasted no time in enacting structural reforms to alleviate indebtedness, to free up the markets and usher in growth. Because Italy has engaged with renewed leadership in the great project which is European integration. And how happy we have been in learning that there is such a worldwide consideration of Europe that it has been given the Nobel Prize for the 50 years that we have brought peace and security together with our great friends in America to bring peace and security to the continent. And that was really a Nobel Prize, which I believe was extremely well deserved. Confidence Confidence in Italy's role in Europe translates into a greater consideration for my country. And it translates into that also and especially in the transatlantic partnership. America can now look at Italy, can now look at our country, not only as its best friend and ally, but also as a very influential friend in the European Union. A partner like Italy, economically viable and politically stable, can only be a strong asset for America. For when it comes to our shared values, interests, and fundamental freedoms, Italy and America will always stand united. Let us, for instance, look at the transformation we are witnessing in the southern shores of the Mediterranean. Winds of change have swept to the Middle East. Oppressed peoples have thrown off the yoke of tyranny and injustice and are marching towards political self-determination. With those people, it is our responsibility to work together. Also, the long-suffering societies of the Middle East have the right to seize this moment to enjoy prosperity and freedom. Domestically, as well as abroad, we should therefore pursue our course with determination, led by our values, by the sense of integrity that we learn from our parents, and by respect for human rights. When I heard I was invited tonight to represent the Italian government, I was especially glad to realize it was mostly due to my efforts, to the efforts of this embassy in Washington, and to the efforts of the Italian Minister of Foreign Affairs, in promoting the Italian language and culture in the United States. But in this endeavor, I have never been alone. So let me thank wholeheartedly the many friends who are here tonight, and the many organizations, and NIAF in particular, which have wonderfully supported this commitment, and they have been so wonderfully supporting the teaching of Italian language through the AP program, and we still need your support to increase the number of students who are committed to our wonderful language. My country's heritage is, in a way, a unique natural resource. We don't have many other natural resources, but culture is the most important, the most fundamental. And since I took office, my guiding light has been to put culture at a very high place in Italian foreign policy. In this spirit, we have launched the Year of Italian Culture in the US in 2013, as Mike Piazza already announced. A year which will have an impressive program of events in arts, literature and sciences. I indeed warmly thank President Obama for the honor he gave us by mentioning this initiative in his Columbus Day proclamation, as well as Secretary Clinton, who just yesterday restated her support. And she said a marvelous sentence. She said at the press conference, yes, 2013 is the year of Italian culture, but every year in America is the year of the Italian culture. And I found it wonderful. Let me also underline the importance of Milan Expo 2015, where we expect a strong American participation and visits from all of you. Come to Milan in a couple of years. It will be wonderful. When I speak of culture, I think of the common identity which makes us all so proud to say we are Italians. A deep belief in solidarity, in integrity, in hard work, a belief which led our ancestors to migrate to the country of freedom, to America. A strong and resilient pride in a great tradition that we wish to preserve and pass over to our children. A creative spirit and a sense of belonging to the very best that Italy embodies. Think of Italian culture as a marvelous, majestic tree. It is rooted in the fertile ground of the Italian Enlightenment, which influenced America's founding fathers. It is nourished by the ancient history of our peninsula. It is inspired by the idea of the Renaissance, by the courage and vision of men like Garibaldi. Union. We want to help this train grow. As an Italian citizen and as Minister of Foreign Affairs, I fervently wish that the present economic juncture, which has been so tough for many people and for many of us, will soon be behind us. There is no doubt in my mind that through smart decisions, spirit of sacrifice and hard work, we will succeed. By joining our efforts, we can make tomorrow a new era of economic recovery that will meet expectations, especially of the young people. We find ourselves in a peculiar point in time. Since the end of the Cold War, no moment has been as distinctively transitional as the one we are living in today. An economic crisis that challenges the very foundations of a system we thought unshakable, a search for a new political identity by people's tired of corrupt and oppressive leadership, a rise of new great powers in deeply diverse cultures. In this reality, choosing the right direction requires a balance of courage and prudence, resolution to act, and willingness to listen. These qualities seem to me as precisely the fruit of our common values.